Today on BRStv, we have episode 19 of the BRS WWC hybrid system, and we're talking fish. Hey, I'm Ryan, your host of BRStv. This week we have episode 19 of the BRS WWC hybrid system, fish. In this series, we're developing a method of dealing with almost every major reefing topic and assembling them into one cohesive system. As you can see, the most recent batch of fish here started a bacterial bloom. There's some pretty interesting notes that we can share on that next week when we do the complete overview. But this week, first we get to the heart of the BRS WWC hybrid methods approach to fish for a reef tank. Before we get too far down this road, I just want to thank Elliot over at marinecollectors.com for helping us stock these tanks. He's helped us out with some awesome fish and been a tremendous resource for a tank like this. All of us have a favorite local fish store and online fish shop, but I think the service that Elliot provides is something different that many reefers may not have been aware of. I just want to hit on this first because if you're stocking your tank, it's as much about a stocking plan and disease prevention plan as it is about a source of fish. Elliot's value here isn't really cheapest or fastest, but more so these three things: assisting with a stocking plan, disease prevention, and lastly, getting them from as close to the source as possible. There is some added cost for this service, but if you let him know what your goals are or simply the fish that you want, he'll walk all of the LA fish wholesalers, which is the first stop for a vast majority of fish that come into the US, then find only healthy specimens, perform a medicated quarantine for you, and set you up for success. I don't use this statement very often, but Elliot probably isn't who I'd use for a single $30 clownfish, but if I'm stocking a new tank or want healthy, high-end fish while protecting the fish I already have, he's probably the only phone call I'd make at this point. He was also originally recommended to me by our resident fish breeder here at BRS, Chad Vossen, because there's a good portion of the advanced reefing community who also feels the same. His website is marinecollectors.com, and if you do contact him, let him know that BRS sent you. At the end of today's video, we'll share some of the fish that Elliot has picked out for us. Okay, so moving on, the first question we always answer in all of this is, what can you expect by doing this well? I mean, regardless of your approach, you nailed it. Well, in this case, I guess I'd say a few things. First, you have a healthy group of fish, well-acclimated fish, but that's really the goal of any tank. With the WWC approach, the goal is really utilitarian fish, meaning these fish serve a purpose, and done well, the fish selection and method of introduction will be a critical component of all kinds of pest prevention, ranging from common algae like green hair algae to more invasive algae, preventing them from ever getting a foothold, and even nudies or parasitic copepods. More or less, the right fish selection is a path to a simple and stable tank. Okay, with that goal in mind, I always like to look at this first from the angle of what almost everyone universally agrees on. By that, I mean like 9 out of 10 reefers. The first thing I'll say is fish are a huge component of algae control on almost every reef tank. If you watch many types of these fish closely, what they're doing 90% of the time is searching the entire tank for any signs of algae to eat. These fish are what keep many tanks in control, the reason they're not overrun with algae, and done right, the reason why many reefers may never run into a single algae struggle. So related to that, one of the most beneficial things you can do is address this as one of the first steps of setting up a new tank. Rather than turn the lights on and algae first, fish second, it's fish first, algae hopefully never. You may never even know algae is an issue because the fish solve it beforehand, invasive species included, when it's kept in check from the beginning. That's one of the major components of the WWC 4-month cycle, adding the fish and then letting them get established long before the lights are turned on. So the question that's asked over and over is, which fish are best? Some of the best are the members of the bristletooth tangs or tenochaetus family, like yellow eye coal tangs, chevron tangs, square tail, white tail, and tomini tangs are popular with some of the smaller tanks. All the bristletooth tangs have mouths that are specialized for eating algae and amongst the best options. Many of them also tend to grow slower and you can get them small to begin with. Right behind that, convict tangs are one of WWC's favorites, as well as purple and yellow tangs. Yellow tangs in particular, because they tend to have a herd mentality and aggressively go after algae patches together. Really, most types of tangs lead algae. Some are just better than others. For example, acanthus-type tangs like powder blue, powder brown, and Achille tangs will eat algae, but they can be less aggressive about it, or at least somewhat less effective algae eaters versus other types. Related to that, small fish like lawnmower blennies are commonly referred to as algae eaters, and they do eat algae, but neither the BRS or WWC teams feel like they actually are going to be a preventative or solution to an algae issue, just a small component of an overall approach. That's gonna be kind of deflating for some because there's not a lot of small fish that are algae eaters, but all the same, I think accurate. So relay that, if you have a small tank, there just aren't a lot of options. The reality is, if you wanna use a tang gang and prevent to algae control, You may just have to accept that you're going to select some of the smaller range of tangs, get them really small, and when they get bigger, donate them to the fish store or trade for smaller ones again. This is a perfectly acceptable solution as long as you follow the advice of occasionally trading down. In fact, as a tank gets older, it's less likely to be dependent on fish for algae control, and you may be able to get something else. Right after that is other types of pests some fish can prevent or control. WWC likes to keep 6 or 8 line wrasses, mystery wrasses, and mandarins for control of coral parasites like nudies and parasitic copepods. The wrasses can be incredibly effective day one at keeping anything like that in check. A mandarin is something that is often added a year or so later in a healthy, robust tank. The bigger, the better. If you have sand in a tight-fitting lid, yellow chorus wrasses, radiant and melanaris wrasse, or others from the halichorus family are awesome at keeping coral parasites in control. In fact, if you have parasites, you may never even know because they do such an awesome job. Lastly, WWC has shared they found scooter blennies to be a solid solution for red flatworms. In the end, all this combined together is what the hybrid method's about: function over form. We all want cool-looking fish, but the focus here is an ecosystem which can take care of itself and lives in balance. The tangang and utilitarian fish being one of the primary pillars of that approach. The last two pieces that they generally agreed upon, even though everyone doesn't follow their own advice, every new fish should be quarantined. What that means to everyone is different and not universally agreed upon, but most of us will agree that regardless of our experiences, relying on luck is not the best path for most reefers and the animals they're attempting to care for. If you're looking for some idea of what a successful approach to quarantining fish looks like, I think a good start is to look at what the people who do this for a living are doing because they have the most practice. On that note, check out the tips and tricks section of the marinecollectors.com site and click on Success with Acanthus Tangs, which has a good portion of how they approach quarantine on a variety of fronts. Again, it's just best to emulate the success of those that do this successfully on a daily basis. I've actually asked him to come to Minnesota and shoot a quick video on how to do this properly. If you'd like to see that, let us know, or even better, let Elliot know. The last thing I'm going to say is near universally true is if you want a tangang or multiple tangs, the best path to that is multiples at the same time. The most aggressive group lasts. If you had a single tang, it will get all the aggression and go poorly. Multiples inherently split up the aggression in most cases. Related to that, smaller fish like schools of anthias or chromis or really any other fish that you put in the tank can serve to break up the aggression. Not by taking it on themselves, by just providing a more diverse community with reduced dominance issues. Okay, related to that, it's time to move on to the debatables. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on the tang police debate or husbandry questions because there isn't a direct one-size-fits-all answer to those questions. The best options is share your particular tank plans with the community or someone you trust and get specific advice to your tank. I think the Reef to Reef Forum and our Ask BRStv Facebook group are good options for that, and in a perfect world, the place that you're buying them from should be able to give you a legit valuable advice on your plans as well. In fact, quality of advice is probably the best direct window into the quality of the entire operation and health of the fish. So in direct relation to that, there are three debatables that we're going to answer. Where's the best place to pick up fish? Is UV really useful? And can a tank really be ick-free? On that first question, if you have reasonably deep pockets, want something special and healthy without a lot of thought put into it, someone like Marine Collectors and Elliot is probably the right option. However, that's probably also like 10% of reefers out there. Most of us are looking for something a bit more simple, and the research is actually part of the hobby to begin with. The first thing I'll share is if you're in the hobby, take the afternoon and drive to every fish store in the area. Local fish stores should be your number one source because they're where you can actually see the health of the fish. Make sure it's eating and get direct, personalized advice from the people who are selling you the fish. It's nearly impossible to beat the service that a high-quality fish store who really cares about the animals and customers can offer you. To identify who's the best, just take a quick look at the store. Does everything look well cared for? Beyond not just having a sick or dead fish in the tank, is the place in the tanks clean? Because while there's room to debate this, to me, clean is synonymous with well cared for. Dirty means neglected and uncared for. Ask a couple questions like, what is the quarantine process here? Maybe a question about the fish that you're thinking about and your tank or their guarantee. It's not a specific answer that you're looking for, just that they seem educated on the topic and confident in their approach. More or less, like any relationship, if they're worthy of your trust. My advice is find the best one and only shop there. Not only will you get the best results for your tank, but supporting their efforts will allow them to continue offering it. That's pretty much true of any type of store that you shop at, but particularly true when shopping for something as critical as animal care and health. Okay, so what if you don't have a good store in your area and need to shop online? Well, I can just speak from my own experience. Online fish for me has been different than online corals. I almost never have issues with online corals, but fish has been a little bit of hit or miss. In this case, I've had issues with all of the ones that I've tried and don't have one that's risen to the top that I would recommend to others, as you can absolutely trust this place. Biggest issues have been order accuracy, visible disease, and I've never once had luck with any of their stay alive guarantees. There's almost always some kind of gotcha or endless runaround. I also share in this case, bigger doesn't necessarily mean better. It may mean better stock levels, but there may be an inverse relationship with other desirable elements. I guess I try and remember that this is a pet or animal that we're dealing with, and there are not many areas in the pet industry where the company that's moving the most pets is actually the option for the healthiest pets. So in that spirit, I tend to look for smaller online shops which answer their emails or phone and can offer a more personalized experience appropriate for buying a pet. So while I can't directly recommend them, I can share that I've ordered from Blue Zoo Aquatics a half dozen to a dozen times in my life. Never had anything die, box comes with some extras for proper acclimation, and just where I find myself checking first when looking for an online fish purchase. Outside of that, I think this is one of those things where it'd be helpful if reefers share where they had the most reliable service in the comments. So what about UV? This has to be one of the most polarized conversations out there. It's debatable for sure, but the debate has become almost political in nature of my way or the highway. I'm just gonna skip the debate and just share what Josh at WWC and I personally believe, as well as almost everyone that I know that takes care of fish for a living. A properly installed and run UV sterilizer is not a replacement for a quarantine process. It will not prevent you from ever running into a fish disease in the tank. However, we all agree that a UV sterilizer will absolutely limit the amount of free floating pathogens and reduce the chances of an issue, particularly when it's combined with other metabolic health approaches, a stable tank environment with proper nutrition. UV will also reduce some forms of algae blooms as well as bacterial blooms, which are also beneficial in a display tank. So Endostore UV is just another redundant but optional component of the life support system that will increase the chances of success long-term and help support the metabolic health when other elements of life support system might be slipping. In relation to that, the ultimate debatable, can the tank be ick-free? Josh and I debated that for a while, and the net of that debate is it's absolutely possible to be ick-free. Ick does not come out of thin air. A medicated tank transfer method can catch all the cycles of the parasite, and if performed properly on every last thing that enters a tank, you can be ick-free. That said, the number of people who perform the tank transfer method 100% properly with zero sources of potential contamination is sub-tenth of a percent. So I'd say it's possible, but maybe not reasonable for most people, and not something that you can actually prove. Only thing I'll share is, regardless of proof, some methods are better than others, and the tank transfer method is one that I believe that science and the supportive approach the most. Okay, so what did Elliot help us out with? So far, he's provided us with the gem tang, an Achilles tang, powder brown, powder blue hybrid, koi parrotfish, Bellis angel, purple tang, as well as a white-tailed tang, a golden dwarf moray eel, an Achilles hybrid, and this is just the beginnings of the tang gang for sure. All these fish are not just serving a utilitarian purpose, but also very attractive additions to the tank. So what's next? I'd like to add some color for the XXL 750 and smaller E170, so probably some anthias. These will also serve at that role of aggression dispersion. We also need some of the parasite predators for the tank, so we'll likely pick up a wrasse or two. On the BRS160 and E170, I also like to pick up a couple smaller bristle-tooth tangs. I also think this will round out the tanks pretty well. That wraps up today's episode. Related to today's topic, check out Randy and I's do-it-yourself fish food episode, where we make fish food from scratch. Or this really cool Magna Talk, which explores a tropical family running a fish collecting business. You can also click on the tab to learn how to get up to $500 in free reefing gear, order refunds, or free carts are just one of the Preferred Reefer perks. See you next week with another episode of BRStv.